Let us look at my definition of what instructional design is. To me, instructional design is a process. It's a systematic and structured method to facilitate learning and teaching based on cognitive neuroscience. It's a very evidence-based scientific process with the use of technology, which has permeated every aspect of society today. And it needs to incorporate all actors involved in education, from the learner to the teacher and to the stakeholders who are going to be using the skills and knowledge of the learner. That's my take on instructional design. The purpose of instructional design is therefore to be able to create instructional materials that are useful for learning. Now, some of us are very familiar with producing our lectures, but are they effective? How can you make it better and easier and hassle-free for the learner to be able to learn? And that's where technology comes in. I bring in the concept of rapid prototyping. You know, most of us are quite obsessive, compulsive. We want our lectures to be perfect, but time doesn't permit that. Resources are limited. And so instructional design provides a platform from which we could rapidly provide educationally sound materials. So we would want to improve it, and that's why it's called rapid prototype. We get a prototype going quick, and as we see how the students and learners use the instructional material, we improve on it. And it can be evaluated by your peers, by experts, and any users. Now, the successive versions of your original product will become better and better, and it enhances its fidelity. So what we are hoping in this workshop we try to do is to create what is business or in entrepreneurship called a minimal viable product. What's the minimum product that you can produce to get some form of returns? So in this workshop, we try to get the minimal viable educational object that you can create by working through the instructional design module. So instructional design models. So what are the models that we have? So a model is just a mental image, a representation of a theoretical concept or foundation through which we could understand and get meaning of the idea. So it's a model so that we can quickly see what this is. And remember to keep this in mind as you provide your teaching. Try and create your own models that will be easy for metacognition to occur so that the learner can look at it and say, ah, I understand this, and this is how I will use this knowledge. The common model used in instructional design is called the ADDIE model, A-D-D-I-E. So this is universally used. The people have modified this, but basically it involves simple steps. The analysis of your instructional material. Who is it for? Why are you doing? What are the contents that's going to be in it? Where is it going to be learned? How are students going to learn this? So these are the questions you want to do in the analysis phase. And then in the design, once you have analyzed the needs for your learning material, the needs of the student, the needs of the employer, then you start designing your material. You design your material based on certain concepts and ideas that make learning to be easy. So if you're going to design a learning material on, say, how to take a blood pressure, and you want to make it a text document, it doesn't make sense. You would rather want to say a video, a quick video, 30 seconds, how to take the blood pressure, or an animation. This would make learning easier. Then you need to develop that product. So once I've designed my instructional material, I need to develop that. And how do I develop that? I start bringing in all the components to it. And it's like building your house. Once you have built it, you build that, you test it, see it works, it seems quite good, the connections are working, the links are working, then you need to implement it. That means I need to take my instructional material and distribute it. It's like cooking. You cook a nice biryani dish, you need a distribution channel. So the distribution can be opening up shop, which is expensive, which requires a lot of resources, or you could vend it, a vending machine. And that's where the distribution channel of learning management system comes about. So that's a vending machine to distribute your product. So you must always think of the end user, how easy it is for him, what are his resources to be able to use your product. And finally, you need to evaluate. Evaluate your program, evaluate your product that you have created, which is a learning material. Is it effective? Does it bring change? Does it make a difference to the outcome in healthcare? If it does, then it's work. If it doesn't, then you need to go back to that process of analysis again and work your way back. We look at what are the steps in the design and development of our instructional material. And this Gagne's 9 events of instruction is very useful, especially in healthcare, in producing our instructional materials. So what do we need? First is to gain attention. So get their attention. What's in it for me? You must fulfill their motivation. Get them motivated why they should learn this module. So by learning this procedure, you're going to save millions of lives. Yeah, so they'll be interested. Then you must tell them the learning objective. So there's a whole workshop on how to write learning objective. Basically, your learning objective must have a noun, a verb, and an adjective, and the context in which you are, the learning has to occur. So the noun is the learner. The verb is the action. What is it that they must do? You must articulate that very clearly. And the adjective is how well must they do it? We'll come to that in the various models of expertise. And then most of our learners are adult learners, and some of them are more advanced, some are not. So you need to recall the prior knowledge, and that you can do with a quiz or something like that, and bring them back, so that they can then do metacognition and attach what they're learning now to what they knew before. And then you present your new knowledge and you guide them through that so that they can understand the connection. And in your own mind, you have certain ways and concepts and frameworks and how you connect the various ideas, help them with that. And then you need to make sure to see whether they have achieved that knowledge. And that is where you elicit performance. So in psychomotor skill, you make them demonstrate. We'll come to some other models which explains how we do that in healthcare. And you need to provide feedback. Feedback is phenomenal in learning, and you provide the feedback that is contextual, timely, authentic, and specific for that learner. And finally, you assess the performance through a formative assessment method, whatever it may be. And in high stakes, you have a summative assessment, and that assessment is for learning, for them to develop. And finally, you ensure there is retention and transfer. And this is when you see them in their working environment doing what you wanted them to do through your teaching. When you create those learning resources, you must understand the dual channel model of learning. This is a theoretical model that's based on the fact that most of us learn not by one single sense. If you look previously, the concept of instructional design and the 5 senses through which we learn. So sight is the common, that we read books, and then the next is auditory. So that's why we have the audiovisual department. This is the dual channel. We need our vision and auditory. And don't forget, in healthcare, sometimes the sensory component is very important, taking the pulse, feeling it. So the sensation, the haptic feedback, helps in the learning process. So multimedia learning, and this is the cognitive theory from Mayer, talks about the use of audiovisual and how you bring them together to help in the learning process. We'll learn more later on, and how you design your learning material using both of these.